good morning, everyone. All right, good to see you here this morning. Let's go to the Lord in prayer, and then we'll begin worship this morning. Heavenly Father, we come before your throne this morning. We're excited to be in your house this morning. Lord, we're expecting for you to work in our lives, to speak to us this morning through your word, through the music. Lord, I just pray that you'll be with Pastor Matt as he brings the message this morning. May you use him. Lord, help us to take the things that may be on our hearts and minds this morning and just set them aside for just an hour or so, Lord, so that we could draw close to you and hear from you and what you want for us this morning. Lord, we love you and we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And if you'll stand with us, we're going to worship together. So much this morning.
Amen.
One, two, three, four.
you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop working, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. You are way, way, way.
worship your holy name and your name alone, because you are the one true God. There is no God before you, beside you, or after you, Lord. We give you all praise and glory that can muster in our souls and our hearts this morning, Lord. And for those of us that might be struggling to muster a word this morning, Lord God, Lord, our prayer would be that you'd be with each one this morning, Lord. For we come into this place this morning to worship and praise your name, Lord. Father, we ask that you be with each one, Lord, whether they be members here at this church, visitors, Lord, or on site, or if they're online with us, Lord. May you touch each one on what they need today, Lord God. We pray that you be with the ones that are struggling financially, struggling with relationships, whether that's with whatever that relationship might be, if it's with a parent, with a spouse, with a child, with a friend, a coworker, Lord, and our relationships can be where they bring us to the highest highs or lowest lows sometimes, Lord God. We pray that you'd be in each of those for each person this day, Lord. Maybe we're struggling with job loss or financial insecurity. Be with those people, Lord. Be with those that might be ailing or sick, Lord, whether they just be a minor temporary thing, Lord, or those that are fighting difficult illness, Lord, in their lives, Lord God. We pray that you'd be with each one, Lord. Give comfort, peace, healing, and recovery for everyone, Lord God. And Lord, today we would pray particularly, Lord, for those that don't know you, Jesus, that have never yielded their lives to you. Lord, we ask that your spirit would move in their heart and life, that today might be their day of salvation. For we know that you tell us in your word that there's no other name under heaven given to men by which we can be saved but at the name of Jesus, Lord. Lord, we pray that you touch those that need you today, Lord, in so many ways, but in particular for salvation, Lord. Thank you for this place that we can come and gather today. We have the freedom to gather in this country, Lord. And though we may have difficulties here, Lord, we know we still have great freedoms that in this world a lot don't, that have to gather in secret, Lord, that we don't have to do that. But Lord, thank you for that, and those that have stood and fought in the past for our freedoms, as well as those today and in the future, Lord God. Be with them, be with their families. Lord, just continue to guide us and direct us. Lead us to your throne of grace and mercy, Jesus. Guide us in your word, Lord. We ask you to be with Pastor Matt this morning, as he would bring your word and preach and share what you put in his heart today, Lord, as he would speak about life. And Lord, use him today, Lord God. Empty him of what you want him to say, Lord. Thank you for the musicians, the singers, Lord, this morning. Appreciate those that serve in this place, Lord. Thank you for all you're doing in our lives individually, as families, collectively, and as a church family as a whole, Lord. Help us to continue to share the gospel of Jesus Christ in our homes, in our neighborhoods, and in our community around Westside, Lord. We give you praise and glory, Lord. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Bobby. Welcome to Westside again.
And we're glad you're here with us this morning in person, or if you're watching online, glad that you're with us. Hopefully that you found the worship just helping you draw close to the Lord this morning. We'll do announcements at the end of the service. I'm Pastor John. Normally would preach, but we're swapping out today. I'm excited for what Matt's going to come talk about with you this morning. So I'm looking forward to being in your spot for once and just soaking in what the Lord has said through Matt here in a few minutes. But most important thing in the bulletin, hopefully you walked in, you got a bulletin there. There's all the announcements on that. But the most important thing on there is that tear out section on the side. If you're visiting with us, this is your first time or second time, all we do is just ask that you fill out that contact information there and just drop it in the offering plate at the end of the service. That's just your record of your attendance with us. If you'd like to know more about our church, there's a box you can check there. If you'd like a visit from one of our pastors, anything like that, we'll be glad to talk with you more about that. So just fill out those appropriate boxes, drop it in the offering plate. The most important thing is on the flip side of that, though. There's a place for you to write any prayer requests that you have. If there's something that we can pray for you about, you can be as descriptive as you want to. You can just say anonymous and please pray for me in unspoken. I'm sorry, there's no one in the back rooms back here making out or anything. It sounds like somebody's kissing. Is it? We're I'm going to turn that off so I won't distract you. We're warming up the baptistry for Myanmar. They're going to baptize this afternoon, so I'm going to turn that off. So that's very distracting. So, but fill out those prayer requests or your contact information there. Just drop that in the offering plate, and we're glad that you chose to visit with us this morning. I hope you feel at home, and we have a little gift we want to give you there. So if you have not received a bag, let us know. We'll make sure we give that to you before the end of the morning. So also in the bulletin, there's a place where we're gifting everybody in our church a subscription to Right Now Media. It's like a Christian Netflix, but it's basically geared towards Bible study. There's a lot of great content for children, videos that are teaching good moral character, but you'll see on that little tear-out flap, there's a QR code there, or you can text that. That's our gift to you. If you're visiting with us, we want to just encourage you to take advantage of that. It's a whole year subscription to Right Now Media. There's tons of Bible study content on there, and we just want to help you as you grow and learn who Christ is and to be more Christ-like. So please take advantage of that, and just anything we can do to help you grow and disciple. Well, let's take a few minutes now and just greet one another and just take a couple of minutes. You can stand up, stretch your legs, maybe give somebody a high five, a handshake, a hug if you want to, and then we'll come back with our message from Pastor Matt here in just a minute. So let's greet one another.
Did that on Friday. we'll get dangerously close to the edge the entire time. Just going to lean over. Don't, no, thank you. All right. Just waiting for my Uncle Al. He talks more than anybody I know, which is surprising considering those of you who know me. All right. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Thank you all for being here, guests, friends. All right, it's fun to have everybody. This is Sanctity of Human Life Sunday, and what I've learned over the years is that what typically happens on Sanctity of Human Life Sunday is there are a lot of preachers or pastors who will take their time and just rail on people, yell and scream at everybody in the outside world. Sort of like a preaching to the choir Sunday, except there are people in the choir who have been wounded with stuff like abortion. Statistics tell us that 1 in 4 women have had one, so that pastor that will stand up behind a pulpit or like I'm doing and will just go off might have no clue that he's wounding people in his congregation. And that's a hard thing, and it's something that I carry a lot. If those of you who know me, you know that I'm the youth pastor here. I'm also in charge of community outreach for Obrea Medical Clinic Gwinnett, classically the Pregnancy Resource Center of Gwinnett. So I spend a lot of time in a lot of places that are either would stand in league with us or might be against us, but love how we do what we do. So I want to start this morning, before we get into the message, just kind of update some updated language used for a long time. One is the word, the term crisis pregnancy, and we've moved away from that for a lot of us kind of in this industry and in this space. One, because the word crisis is such a negative word, and pregnancy is a beautiful thing. Unplanned, unexpected, however you want to call it. We like unplanned or unexpected. But it's a beautiful thing, as a child is never a crisis, and a pregnancy is never the crisis. All right, this is a church where I hope everyone knows that if someone comes in and they're not married but they're pregnant, we're going to love them and be excited for them, be excited for that baby. We will throw you a baby shower. We will have fun, because that's what we're supposed to do. Right? Children are this beautiful thing. But the other reason I don't like it is because it implies that the pregnancy is the crisis itself, and it's really not. Sometimes it's maybe a crisis lifestyle, or like a high stress, right, low safety net lifestyle. Let me put it like this. There's a guy out of Chicago that I follow. His name is Ryan Dowd. He used to run the second largest homeless shelter in Chicago. They did a study, and he said, if you become homeless, the moment you become homeless, your IQ drops by at least 13 points. And he said, if you don't believe me, get a full night's rest, go to sleep, get a good night's rest, wake up in the morning, have your breakfast, have your coffee, take an IQ test. Go to work, do all your normal stuff, stay up all night, be in that low rest area, take the IQ test again, it'll drop by at least 13 points, right? Because the way our brains operate in that space, right, when you're in high stress mode, your ability to like function really good cognitively drops. So a lot of the patients we see at Obrea are in high stress lifestyles. It is kind of a constant, what do I do? What's the day look like? What does the next hour look like? How do I pay my bills? Am I going to keep my cell phone? It's those kind of things. Pregnancy is not the crisis. And sometimes it's just someone who let their emotions and arousal go a little bit too far. It's a fair thing to say. The next thing, the term pro-life. I know everybody in here, most people in here rather, would say they're pro-life. I like the term life-affirming a lot more for a couple of reasons. One, in that pro-life space, it's become so political and so angry, and people just kind of rail either for or against it. Life-affirming. At Obrea, we call ourselves a life-affirming medical clinic because we affirm the dignity of every life that walks through our doors, whether we see that life or not. Unique story. We have a couple going through our prenatal care program. We offer prenatal care at low to no cost. Nobody else would see them, so they landed to us, this Christian organization. The husband there is a biological female. The husband is a biological female, identifies as a man, and is pregnant. The wife is a biological male, identifies as a female. When they got pregnant, they went to get prenatal care, and nobody else would take them. then they call us. And we said, absolutely. Our job is to love. We think about what, right, what would Jesus do? Jesus would say, come on, our doors are open and we're here for you. So they're getting really great prenatal care because we're life-affirming. Because we don't care what they look like. We don't care how they identify. We care that they need medical care and that they bear the image of God. Lastly, the terms crisis pregnancy center, pregnancy care center, pregnancy resource center. Quite a few of us are moving away from the one using the word pregnancy and the title. Because if someone's pregnant, they don't want to be. They don't want to go to a pregnancy care center, a pregnancy resource center, a crisis pregnancy center. They want to go someplace that's different. So when we joined Obria in 2017, we really like it. Obria Medical Clinic Gwinnett. Obria is the only, I have to say all this a lot, right? It's the only accredited, nonprofit, life-affirming prenatal care women's clinic in Northeast Georgia. The accredited part matters a lot, and I'm going to say something and all of you are going to go, wow, you're really not. We are accredited through AAAHC. It's the Accreditation Association for Ambulatory Healthcare. And I know, wow, right? Thank you. Amy works at a hospital, right? You're familiar with Joint Commission. They're on par with Joint Commission. There are other places they come in. They look at about 500 points. It is a hectic time, right? When Joint Commission walks in the hospital, everybody is like, T's are crossed twice, I's are dotted twice, and it's the same with Joint Commission. It's a heavy thing. If you see me touch this, it's because I really hate this thing around my ear, so I apologize. But we're accredited. That means an outside organization came to see what we do, see how we do it, and make sure we do it the way we say we do. What's really cool is if someone was to publicly say, you guys are a fake clinic, you don't do what you really do, you're not really medical, and they publish that, AAAHC can sue them for libel, which is great. And they know we're a Christian organization, so it's really, really fun. All right, so let's get into today's message. Lyle, for those of you who don't know him, one of our deacons, we're looking at Genesis 38 and John 4. And Lyle goes, you're looking at Genesis 38 through John 4? That's a lot to go into. I said, oh, I grew up Pentecostal. It's going to be a long message. I hope everybody brought a snack. So life matters. We're going to go through some pictures. The question about life matters is really, what does that mean? What does that look like? So we're going to go through some pictures, and we're going to see which life matters more. All right, we've got Steve Bennett, fresh off his national championship victory with the University of Georgia. Amen. And then Nick Saban, the head coach of Alabama. Right? Which life matters more? All right, next picture. You have, if you can see that, that's actually a glove. That's a little child growing, right, in a glove. It's being held. And then there's a sweet old woman, right? Which life matters more? It's going to get progressively more difficult, I promise. All right, what's next? Joe Biden and Donald Trump. All right. Which matters more? And then this one, we're going to pause here. This, on one side, you see a Black Lives Matter activist with a sign saying, stop kill us. And on the other side is Dr. Ben Carson, right, a conservative politician who is the Secretary of Home and Housing, something like Secretary of Housing, with the Trump administration. With those, right, which life matters more? And it's one of those hard things. Because we have to ask ourselves, which life matters more? So as we get ready, we can move on from this one. All right, we're looking at Genesis 38 and John 4, Judah and Tamar and the woman at the well. And the question, it's your first notes there, the question to think about this morning, how do I decide which lives are more valuable to me? Now, if you've ever been at the grocery store, if you're anything like me or my dear Uncle Al or probably my friend Chris, right, you will just talk to people. This is what we do. We just talk to people. It's just our natural inclination to talk. If you're talking to somebody, right, you cut up, right? I think right now it's, oh my gosh, the eggs are crazy. What is the price of eggs? What's the deal with that? And you could talk to someone randomly and like, wow, that's right. You know, we agree. You run into each other throughout the store. Hey, it's you again. I typically get the, excuse me, can you reach this on the top shelf for me? This is one of the things that happens when you're tall. We can go backwards real quick. Sorry. But let's say you're going to the grocery store and you're talking to them, right? And you're getting along, right? It's just the cutting up. And you even check out maybe at the same time. And as you're walking out in the parking lot, you're talking to them. And then you split ways to go to your car. And you see on their car a bumper sticker of the opposite political party. And what's the thought that goes through your head? Man, I thought they were cool. I thought they were a good person. But they vote the other way. What changes? Why did their life become less valuable? Now they vote. It's a little bit convicting. And I have to tell you, when I was prepping this message, all of this stuff was really convicting to me. And it's one of those things where you're writing it down and you're taking notes and you're going, oh, Lord, please, why? Like, why is that on my heart? And God says, well, because you got to work on it too, bud. So, all right, we're gonna look at what to expect of Genesis 8. That's the scripture here. All right, so we have wicked men, Genesis 38. We'll pause on this slide while I read. If you want to go ahead and open up your Bibles to Genesis 38. Wicked men, a duplicitous father-in-law. I just like the word duplicitous. It was fun to put up there. And a righteous daughter-in-law. So we have some wicked men, his father-in-law, and a righteous daughter-in-law. So here we go, starting in verse 1. About this time, Judah left home and moved to Adullam, where he stayed with a man named Hira. Just in case you're wondering what that means, about this time, they had just finished selling off Joseph to Midianite traders, so he had just sold off his little brother. Oh, good old Judah. Jesus, the Lion of Judah, came from the line of Judah. So Judah, about this time, had just finished selling off his brother, and then he moves. So about this time, Judah left home and moved to Adullam, where he stayed with a man named Hira. There he saw a Canaanite woman, the daughter of Shua, and he married her. When he slept with her, she became pregnant and gave birth to a son, and he named the boy Ur. When she became pregnant again and gave birth to another son, then she named him Onan, or Onan, however you want to say that. And when she gave birth to a third son, she named him Shelah. At the time of Shelah's birth, they were living in Kezeb. In the course of time, Judah arranged for his firstborn son, Ur, to marry a young woman named Tamar. But Ur was a wicked man in the Lord's sight, so the Lord took his life. It's a happy ending there. Then Judah said to Ur's brother Onan, go and marry Tamar, as our law requires of the brother of a man who has died. You must produce an heir for her brother. But Onan was not willing to have a child that would not be his own heir. So whenever he had intercourse with his brother's wife, he spilled the semen on the ground. This prevented her from having a child who would belong to his brother. But the Lord considered it evil for Onan to deny a child to his dead brother. So the Lord took Onan's life too. Then Judah said to Tamar, his daughter-in-law, go back to your parents' home and remain a widow until my son Shelah is old enough to marry you. But Judah didn't really intend to do this because he was afraid that Shelah would also die like his two brothers. Even though, right, they were the evil ones. But we'll just hold on to that. So Tamar went back to live in her father's home. Some years later, Judah's wife, some years later, Judah's wife died. And when the time of mourning was over, Judah and his friend Hira the Adullamite went up to Timnah to supervise the shearing of his sheep. Someone told Tamar, look, your father-in-law is going up to Timnah to shear his sheep. Tamar was aware that Shelah had grown up, but no arrangements had been made for her to come and marry him. So she changed out of her widow's clothing and covered herself with a veil to disguise her. Then she sat beside the road at the entrance of the village off Enam, which was on the road to Timnah. Judah noticed her and thought she was hot, or that she was a prostitute, however you want to say it. Right? Every translation is different, since she had covered her face. So he stopped and propositioned her. Let me have sex with you, he said, not realizing that it was his own daughter-in-law. Again, we're seeing a pattern here. Well, how much will you pay me to have sex with you? Tamar asked. I'll send you a young goat from my flock. Oh, what a deal, Judah promised. Yeah. Well, you can hear. Here's a goat. What will you give me to guarantee you that you will send the goat, she asked. What kind of guarantee do you want? She said, leave me your identification seal and its cord and the walking stick you are carrying. Leave me your credit card, your driver's license, and your social security card. And Judah gave them to her. Very bad idea. But then he had intercourse with her, and she became pregnant. Afterwards, she went home, took off her veil, and put on her widow's clothing as usual. Later, Judah asked his friend Hira the Adullamite to take the young goat to the woman and later pick up the things he had given to her as his guarantee. But Hira couldn't find her. So he asked the men who lived there, "Where can I find the shrine prostitute who was sitting beside the road at the entrance to Enium?" Biblical names are hard. Ask any of the students or most of the adults. "We've never had a shrine prostitute here," they replied. So Hira, scratching his head, returned to Judah and said, "I couldn't find her anywhere, and the men of the village claim they've never had a shrine prostitute there." "Well, let her keep the things I gave her," Judah said. "And I sent the young goat as we agreed, but you couldn't find her. We'll be the laughingstock of the village if we went back to look for her." About 3 months later, Judah was told, "Tamar, your daughter-in-law, has acted like a prostitute, and now because of this, she's pregnant. Bring her out and let her be burned," Judah demanded. Never mind, he sold off his brother, and he himself thought, bring her out, let her be burned, because, right, she's the unrighteous one, apparently. But as they were taking her out to kill her, she sent this message to her father-in-law: "The man who owns these things made me pregnant. Look closely. Whose seal and cord and walking stick are these? Or whose face is this on the driver's license? Whose social security number is this? Whose credit card is this?" Judah recognized him immediately and said, "She is more righteous than I am, because I didn't arrange for her to marry my son Sheila." And Judah never slept with Tamar again. When the time came for Tamar to give birth, it was discovered that she was carrying twins. While she was in labor, one of the babies reached out his hand. The midwife grabbed it and tied a scarlet string around the child's wrist, announcing this one came out first. But when he pulled back his hand, out came his brother. "What?" the midwife exclaimed. "How did you break out first?" So he was named Perez. And the baby with the scarlet string on his wrist was born, and he was named Zerah. So, looking at these things, wicked men, obviously Judah's first two sons, a duplicitous father-in-law, Judah, and a righteous daughter-in-law. Real quick question. Anybody else ever heard of a prostitute being called righteous? Rahab? Yeah? What about today? If you saw a prostitute, do you think, "Wow, like, there's a righteous woman"? But what if I was to tell you that the vast majority of prostitutes are being trafficked? That they're in slavery? They don't have much of a way out. Right, that's just a weighty thing. I wasn't initially planning to mention that, but it's a true thing. They get bailed out pretty quickly, because if they're in jail, their pimp can't use them. All right, we're going to move on to the main point here. Is my feeling of moral superiority ruining my witness? See, Judah, right, who lied to his daughter-in-law, then had sex with her because he thought she was a prostitute, wanted to burn her when he found out she was pregnant. So, Judah, the guy who sold off his brother because he was jealous of him, because apparently Joseph's coat was so nice. Joseph has a pretty coat. I didn't get a pretty coat. Gives his first son to a woman. He dies because he's evil. Second son dies because he's evil. Third son, no, we're not doing that. I don't want him to die too. Goes and has sex with a prostitute, I guess because he was lonely because his wife died and he was weird like that. Pretends to be the righteous one here. So burn my daughter. Burn my daughter-in-law. We got to kill her. How dare she, outside of the bonds of marriage, get pregnant? I can have sex with a prostitute, but she can't. Okay, I'll weigh these out real quick. This is going really well for Judah. But the thing is, church, we tend to do this. When we read about Jesus, when we read about how he talks to the Pharisees, and we think, "Yeah, I get those Pharisees." How often are we the Pharisees? How often do we see things and make comments about them? Right? How often do we see a young person come in with jeans with holes in them? And we say something along the lines, because this is what I've heard it said, "Did you buy it like that on purpose?" When what we should be saying is, "Hey, thanks for being here at church." Right? So if you got young people who are wearing a t-shirt or a hoodie or jeans with holes in them, because maybe they did buy them like that because they liked the way they looked. Instead of the comment, you buy them like that on purpose? Why would you look like that? Why do you want to be like that? Say, hey, thanks for being here. Thanks for being in church on a Sunday or a Wednesday when you could easily be somewhere else. Because it sure is easy to be somewhere else now. Right? Most of us grew up going to church, and that's what everybody did. The people who didn't go to church, you were like, well, you don't go to church? I think we just assumed they were Jewish. All right, they go to church on Saturday. Fantastic. And the people that didn't, we're like, well, how do you not do that? But right, we spent a long time, especially on Sundays like this, Sanctity of Human Life Sunday, railing on people who aren't like us because we're more righteous than they are. And then we wonder why people don't want to come to church. We wonder why the number of people who call themselves Christian is dropping, and the number of people who would describe themselves as none, having no faith, no religion, is on the rise. And we can blame the world, right? We can blame TV. We can't blame MTV anymore. Right? MTV is not really a thing now. But we blame other stuff. But yet we never look at ourselves. We never look at the person who walks out the grocery store and sees a political sticker on a car and instantly gets angry. Or instantly goes, I thought they were good. It's my feeling of moral superiority ruining my witness. I can tell you it has mine, which is really kind of a crummy thing. When you're getting ready to teach something about life, and this idea for a note comes up, and you just start to cringe a little bit when you think about the times when it has. All right, my mom is here this morning, and there are plenty of times where she said, Matt, you are acting a lot holier than thou. I've been like, you're right. You don't have to say it out loud, Mom, but you're right. But look at these pictures. These are people standing outside an abortion clinic. Right, Planned Parenthood, your choice. But look at this older gentleman here. The top sign says, forgive the coerced, the abused, and the confused, and the alone, and then the damned, the abortionists and supporters. So this guy's a Christian telling people that they're damned. Ooh, fantastic. Where's your church? I want to come there. I want to come to the place that if I've made a mistake or I participated in something that maybe I shouldn't have, you're going to let me know how damned I am. I said damned a little bit too much, I think, for a church message. But what does that say? What does that say for people who are on the margins, maybe who have a Christian friend who's pretty cool, but then they see other Christians like this? Oh man, well, I got one friend, they're good. But the rest of them, I can't be around that. What does that say? Because I've got a friend who previously worked at the Atlanta Women's Health Clinic, Atlanta Feminist Women's Health Clinic, where they provided abortions. And she was in charge of the healthcare resources for transgender individuals. She reached out to me. I know I've shared this story before, I think, but she reached out to me in the middle of the pandemic and said, hey, Matt, I just want to thank you for being the only person I know that's a Christian, that's actually a Christian. Because she grew up in church, and church ruined her because of the way people acted and the way they talked. She said, you're the only person who consistently reaches out to me and wants to check on me, make sure I'm doing okay. She said, some major health problems. She said, you're the only Christian I know who actually lives out this faith in real life because you pray for me. And we've had conversations. We are total opposites in a lot of ways. But she's a dear friend and I love her. But this guy's supposed to be on our team. I kind of don't want a team player like that. Does his life matter? Absolutely. Is he a child of God? Absolutely. Does he bear the image of God? Absolutely. But he's saying that other people do too. Because he's saying if you're supporting in this, then you're damned to hell. As though what they've done is unforgivable. Let's look at the next slide. Because you can see the picture in the bottom, I guess, right-hand corner for you. This is the story of Emmett Till. Emmett Till was a young black teenage boy in the 1950s from Chicago. Some of you might know this story. goes down to Mississippi to visit some family. And as the story was told initially, he walked into a grocery store and did a wolf whistle at a white woman. It's Mississippi in the 1950s. There are conflicting reports of what really happened. But we know what happened. There's two men, white men, found him, beat him, burned him, lynched him, threw his body. He was found a few days later, shipped back to Chicago. His mom said, "We're going to have an open casket. You're going to print this picture in your newspapers because this is ridiculous." This really kicked off the civil rights movement heavy in the United States. That tells a young man, the verdict, 67 minutes, they were found not guilty. Found not guilty. Years later, they actually wrote a book where they admitted everything that they did. Because you can't be tried again. It's double jeopardy. You can't be tried for murder if you've already been found not guilty of a murder. The two men that did this and the woman who was involved, the rest of their lives, and now, do their lives matter? Absolutely. They bear the image of God just as much as Emmett Till did? Absolutely. But here's the thing that these, what happened to them, is they had to move town because nobody was going to do business with them. One of them was living in Texas, saw someone from his town. He said, hey, I'm from there. I'm so-and-so. They heard his name and they turned and they walked the other way. They had very awful lives. I think it was the woman who in the 80s, maybe late 80s, late 80s, early 90s, something like that. She said, "Everybody keeps bringing up Emmett Till and it bothers me." She's going through the story because everybody keeps talking about him. And why can't, and he said, "He's already dead. Why can't we just let him stay dead? Why do I have to keep hearing about it?" Well, it's highly likely he actually didn't do anything because there are so many conflicting reports. But he got burned and beaten and lynched and tossed in a river at 14 years old. If you remember the South in the 1950s, everybody went to church. Everybody went to church. This young man who did nothing, and even if he did say something, it's not worth his life. In that moment, his life didn't matter. So often on these Sunday mornings, we talk about abortion. How is this any better? Right, and it's not. So, we're going to look at the story. Well, the woman at the well. There's what we got. We have a very broken woman, a loving Savior, some very confused disciples because she was Samaritan, and then people's value restored. I could read this out, but instead we're going to watch a clip from The Chosen. If you haven't watched The Chosen yet, it's a series about Jesus and his disciples, and it's phenomenal. It is just amazing. So we're going to get to that. We're going to play the video, and I will move down from the stage because it's awkward to be pushing up here when the video is being played.
"Would you give me a drink?" "Did you hear me?"
"That's bad, huh?"
"What?"
"You, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a Samaritan, and a woman."
"I'm sorry. I should have said please."
"You know, it's not safe for you to be alone out here."
"Nor you. Why haven't you come with others? Why so late in the day? Don't women come to the wells in the cool of the morning?"
"Yeah, well, none of them will be seen with me, so I have to come out alone in the heat, as you have so kindly reminded me."
"Why won't they be seen with you?"
"Long story."
I'd still like a drink of water if you can spare it."
"Amazing what a parched throat will do. Aren't I unclean to you? Won't you be defiled by this vessel?"
"Maybe some of my people say that about your women, but I don't."
"Yeah? And what do you say?"
"I say if you knew who I am, you'd be asking me for a drink."
"Really?"
"And I would give you living water."
"Would, except that you have nothing to draw water with, and this is a deep well. Besides, What do you need from me if you have your own supply of living water?
Long story.
But Jewish water is better than Samaritan water.
That's not what I said.
Are you a better man than our ancestor Jacob, who dug this well? Your water is better than his?
I know Jacob. And everyone who drinks this water will thirst again. But whoever drinks the water that I give him will never be thirsty again.
Wouldn't that be nice?
The water I give will become in a person a spring of water welling up to eternal life.
Really?
Yes, really.
Prove it.
First, go and call your husband and come back. I will show you both.
I don't have a husband.
You are right. You've had 5 husbands. And the man you're living with now is not your husband.
Oh, I see. You're a prophet. You're here to preach at me.
No.
Usually the one good thing about coming here alone is I can escape being condemned.
I'm not here to condemn you.
I've made mistakes. Too many. But it's men like you who have made it impossible for me to do anything about it.
How?
Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain. But you Jews insist Jerusalem is the only place for true worship.
They say that because the temple is there.
Exactly where we're not allowed.
I'm here to break those barriers. And the time is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father.
So, where am I supposed to go when I need God? I've never received anything from God, but I couldn't thank him even if I did.
Anywhere. God is spirit. And the time is coming and is now here that it won't matter where you worship, but only that you do it in spirit and truth. Heart and mind, that is the kind of worshiper he's looking for. It won't matter where you're from or what you've done. Do you believe what I'm telling you?
Until the Messiah comes and explains everything and sorts this mess out, including me, I don't trust in anyone.
You're wrong when you say that you've never received anything from God. This Messiah you speak of, I am he. The first one was named Ramin. You were a woman of purity who was excited to be married. But he wasn't a good man. He hurt you. And it made you question marriage and even the practice of your faith.
Stop it.
The second was Farzad. On your wedding night, his skin smelled like oranges. And to this day, every time you pass by the oranges in the market, you feel guilty for leaving him. Because he was the only truly godly man you've been with. But you felt unworthy.
Why are you doing this?
I have not revealed myself to the public as the Messiah. You are the first. It would be good if you believed me.
You picked the wrong person.
I came to Samaria just to meet you. I think it's an accident that I'm here in the middle of the day.
I am rejected by others.
I know. But not by the Messiah.
And you know these things because you are the Christ.
Counting on it.
Spirit and truth.
Spirit and truth.
It won't be all about mountains or temples.
Soon, just the heart.
Rabbi, we got food. What would you like?
I have food to eat that you do not know about. Who got you food?
That clip is just, I love that, because what you see is both the humanity and the divinity of Jesus in that, right? With the chosen, they have to take a little bit of liberty to get to a place of what Jesus was like when he walked on the earth. And I think what you see is that humanity side of Jesus. Right? Because we often forget that he was a man too, which meant that he was thirsty, and he was tired, and he hurt. Right, the scripture says, you know, but if a sheep loses one, if a shepherd loses one of his sheep, they leave the 99 to go find the one. And what we see with the story of the woman in the well, Jesus went to find that one. And the one wasn't even Jewish. The one was impure. The one was a relative, a half-breed, someone that nobody should be seen with, no one should talk to. And I'm talking to a woman, but none of them had the nerve to ask him, what do you want with her? Or why are you talking to her? Right? Who gave him food? Who gave you food? Right? They asked that. Then she goes into the village, and they ask Jesus to stay for a couple of days, and he does. And at the end they said to the woman, now we believe, not just because of what you told us, because of what we have heard him, because we have heard him ourselves. Now we know that he is indeed the Savior of the world. So Jesus goes to Samaria, to the place that none of the other Jews are going to go, right? He didn't have to walk through Samaria. It was the shortest route, but he didn't have to walk there. He could have circled around like every other Jewish person does. But he walked into Samaria and got some water, talked to someone who was very lost and very broken. Then out of that, an entire village comes to know the Savior. So Jesus is the first one to go to people nobody else wanted to go to. People that I avoid who need to hear the good news. And we do, right? We avoid people because we don't like the way they look. We don't like their style. We don't like how they vote. We don't like how they responded to us on social media. They're not on our side of the tracks. Kind of the term was. They don't live in our neighborhood. They live in a place that's not safe. It's a place I don't want to go. What I've learned about some of the not safe places around here, as I've walked in with John and Dave and Darren and Bobby and Johnny, as we've gone to these places, I've seen when you look at someone and you shake their hand and you invite them, even if they don't come, they're just glad that someone saw them as a human. And again, I'm not perfect at this. We had a visitor a few months ago who helped us move some stuff over. And it's a biological man transitioning to a woman. As we're coming back across the street, I had an offhand comment, and Darren very rightly said, Matt, and it's hard to stand up here, know what you're going to talk about, and remember getting called out by a friend and a leader who had every right to do it. Needed to hear the good news. And what if I had been the only person that they had come into contact with? What happens then? What happens when young people hear someone get mad about a Christmas decoration? I don't like that. I don't want that up in here. And what happens when a senior adult gets made fun of by a young person. Right? We all have value because of who we are. But church should be the place that we're all welcome. But we avoid people. We want our church full, but do we want it full? Right? What if they haven't showered? What if they're coming and they've been hurt by church before and they just want to give it one more chance? They come in, they see some donuts and coffee. And they get told, hey, by the way, when you come, you can wear a hoodie and jeans. And that's okay. There are people I avoid who need to hear the good news. But what happens? How do we decide who values or what life we value? That's a big question. What determines how I value life? Right? You have your feelings. My feelings lead to my thoughts. My thoughts lead to my actions. My actions lead to my words. I feel a certain way about someone, so I think about them differently. We talked about the eggs in the grocery store, but ooh, they've got that Biden-Harris 2020 or Trump-Pence 2020, depending on which way you lean. Or they've got a coexist sticker on there. Or you're driving and they cut you off, they've got a Christian fish on the car. So there's a reason I don't have the fish on my car. I'm not that good of a driver. My wife, my mother-in-law, my mom, John, can attest to that. Right, so I feel a certain way about them, so I start to think a certain way about them, a certain way around them, and then I say something to them. All right. I said this earlier. I feel, I remember growing up, because this is what you did in church, right? You dressed for church. You put on your best for church to make sure that everybody knew that you dressed up for Jesus when Jesus walked around and had dirty feet. Who was I dressing up for? And I didn't really ever dress up, right? It's, in fairness, I think, Mom, I think you said, I never really dressed up for church. That's what church did. But what if somebody comes in again? It's a student, they come in with holes in their jeans. You feel like that shouldn't be. Then you think, I don't like that. And your actions, your face starts to turn a little bit. And you say, why would you wear that to church? It's disrespectful. To who? Really, to who? You're at church. Church is a hospital. It takes people that are hurt and broken and do our best to get fixed to Jesus. That gets to the bottom. If I claim to value life, I need to value everyone that Jesus values. And that means everyone. Because there's not a one of us in here or outside the walls or in the neighborhoods around us that Jesus doesn't value, that Jesus didn't die for. If he died for all of our sins, like and the sins we don't like. It includes the people we like and the people we don't like. It includes cashier at McDonald's and the Santa Claus that fit. That Santa, if I remember right, makes about six figures working just a short amount of time. That's why I want to get fat and have a beard and go be that Santa Claus. So see y'all later. Right, but it's the homeless person that sleeps outside my clinic at Obria. His name is Darnell. He's a friend. We have each other's phone numbers. We talk, we text, we catch up. I spend part of my day just chatting with God. Just hit a rough patch of life. But needed a place to feel safe, and he's safe with us. It's also a gentleman that I know, Clyde Strickland, who is very rich, has his name on a few places in Gwinnett County. He's a Christian, but will happily tell you where his name is. To him, because he has money, and they want his money. His wife is a cancer survivor. An amazing woman. And she's what drives a lot of that. Whose life values? I claim to value. And I need to value everyone that Jesus values. And that means the people that I avoid and need to hear the good news. It means the senior adult at the senior home, then no family coming to visit. But Johnny and his friend come up and they sing and they play. John goes with him. Meet a teenager in our lobby at Christmas time, laughing at Buddy the Elf and enjoying him being up. So as they come up to close us out here, guys, if you want to come up and start playing, whoever's doing that. I have a question. As we come, we open up the altar. Hey, now if you Jesus, what that looks like, I'm happy to talk to you. John's happy to things here with. But if there's been a time in your valued someone like I have, and I have to tell you, it's fun. Maybe this altar needs to be open so that you've this. You not only have a chance to right that wrong, but you sure right it with God. Amen. So as these play, Walker. Not someone. Child too. Ask for the time for value. And be thankful that you never did. We continue to be so. Everyone that walks through that loves them no matter. You go home. Someone will come up and do announcements. I don't know. Thank you for this Sunday. job is to be impactful in the way we give. That we use.
Good job.
Thank you.